family just changing. And it's not only the structure that matters. What really matters is whether or not there is love in the family. You know, this whole idea that love makes a family. It doesn't really matter how it's configured, but what really matters is whether or not there's love in the family. And one point that I want to make to you today is there's actually a connection between the structure of the family and the love in the family. So I agree, love makes a family, but it's also the case you're much more likely to get that love in certain types of family contexts. So on average, we know that kids who are reared in single-parent homes are 2 to 3 times more likely to experience serious negative outcomes, things like depression, delinquency, dropping out of high school, et cetera. And it's about 10% of kids who are in intact married households who experience these things. About 25 to 30% of kids who are in single-parent households will experience these things. And so it's important when we think about this particular issue that we don't kind of overplay our hand. We don't kind of exaggerate the problem. I was raised by a single mother, and I think she did a pretty good job of raising me. And you know, many kids who are reared in a single-parent household turn out okay, you know, in some important way. Nevertheless, it is the case that there is a higher risk for these kids of having some major problem. And when you kind of think about this issue in the aggregate, kind of for a community, for a neighborhood, for a nation, these differences really play out in important ways, as we'll see in a couple of slides, you know, down the road. And of course, once again, these are the kinds of differences you'd actually see for something like smoking. You know, most people who smoke don't end up with lung cancer. Nevertheless, if you smoke regularly, you're dramatically increasing your odds of acquiring lung cancer. And of course, we take that pretty seriously in our society, and I think we probably should take this issue also seriously. Yes?
So this last point, 25% of children in biological single-parent homes, does that number change where it's not the biological single-parent, so if an adult adopts, does that number change, or does it
still? Well, actually, kids who are in intact adoptive homes do pretty well, except they're more likely to experience you know, some kind of psychological issues around just sort of questions about their identity, you know, their roots, you know, what happened to their parents, you know, how do they relate to their biological parents. But besides that particular issue of sort of the identity question for adoptive kids, they do about as well as kids who are in intact biological married families.
Just like that smoking example you just talked about, there's second degree smoke and then they've discovered a new kind of smoke damage called third degree smoke. So we see like a trickle down effect with smoking, and there's the same kind of trickle down effect with divorce, but we don't know exactly how far that reaches. So I'm wondering what the long-term effects on the future marriages of the children and the grandchildren of divorced parents are. I mean, I know they're more likely to get divorced themselves if their parents were, but like, how eventually is that going to break down procreative abilities in cultures? Because already we're seeing in Europe less children being born than are replaced, like the population replacement rate has gone down.
So one of the points that she is making is that these patterns tend to have kind of an intergenerational character to them. So the kids who are born and reared in a household that is affected by divorce are themselves more likely to experience divorce when they are adults. It's about 80% more likely to get divorced when they're married themselves. So in a sense, you know, the sins of the fathers are visited upon the next generation. And we also know that grandparents are less likely to have good relationships with their grandchildren if their kids get divorced. So there is a big intergenerational piece to this whole story here. And I'm happy to kind of address that maybe after the talk in more detail if you want me to. So if we kind of think about the consequences of single parenthood for kids, there are psychological consequences, things like suicide, social effects, things like delinquency, and their economic consequences, things like poverty. And I'm just going to go quickly through a couple of slides to illustrate these basic trends in more detail to kind of show you how this plays out in the real world. So when it comes to boys and to men, one clear effect of being raised by a single mom in this case is that you have an increased risk of ending up in prison as a young man or as a teenage boy. So about 11% of boys who are reared by a single mom will end up in prison or in jail at some point in their lives before they turn age 32. And that compares to about 5% of boys who are reared by their intact married parents. And I think this suggests that dads in particular play an important role in the lives of their sons.